Good morning. I'd like to welcome all of you here this morning as we celebrate the life of our dear friend and resident at Windcrest, Paul Phillips. Shelter of the Lord, who abide in his shadow for five. Say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock, in whom I trust, and I will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. The snare of the fowler will never capture you, and famine will bring you no fear. Under his wings your refuge, his faithfulness your shield, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand.
The Lord of hosts will provide for all peoples. On this mountain he will destroy the veil that veils all peoples, the web that is woven over all nations. He will destroy death forever. The Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces. The reproach of his people he will remove from the whole earth, for the Lord has spoken. On that day it will be said, behold our God, to whom we looked to save us. This is the Lord to whom we looked. Let us rejoice and be glad that he has saved us. The word of the Lord. My soul is thirsting for the living God. When shall I see him face to face? Thirsting to the God, when shall I see him face to face? As the deer longs for the running waters, so my soul longs for you, O God. My soul is thirsting for the living God, whom shall I see you face to face? A thirst is my soul for God, the living God. When shall I go and behold the face of God? My soul is thirsting for the living God, when shall I see him face to face? I went with the throng and led them in procession to the house of God, amid loud cries of joy and thanksgiving, with a multitude keeping festival. My soul is thirsting for the living God. When shall I see him face to face? Send forth your light and your fidelity. They shall lead me on and bring me to your holy mountain, to your dwelling place. My soul is thirsting for the living God. When shall I see him face to face? Then will I go into the altar of God, the God of my gladness and joy. Then will I give you thanks upon the harp, O God, my God. My soul is thirsting for the loving God. When shall I see him face to face? Why are you so downcast, O my soul? Why do you sigh within me? Hope in God, for I shall again be thanking him in the presence of my Savior and my God. My soul is thirsting for the living God. When shall I see him face to face? And the second reading is from the book of Revelation. I saw a new heaven and a new earth. The former heaven and the former earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. I also saw the holy city, a new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, God's dwelling is with the human race. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will always be with them as their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, or mourning, wailing, or pain, for the old order has passed away." The one who sat on the throne said, "Behold, I make all things new. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give a gift from the spring of life-giving water. The victors will inherit these gifts, and I shall be their God, and they shall be my own." And this is the word of the Lord.
And the Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Now that very first day of the week, two of the disciples were going to a village 7 miles from Jerusalem called Emmaus. And they were conversing about all the things that had occurred. And it happened that while they were conversing and debating, Jesus himself drew near and walked with them. But their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. As they approached the village to which they were going, he gave the impression that he was going on farther. But they urged him, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening and the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. And it happened that while he was with them at table, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them. With that, their eyes were opened. And they recognized him, but he vanished from their sight. Then they said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he spoke to us on the way and opened the scriptures to us?" So they set out at once and returned to Jerusalem, where they found gathered together the 11 and those with them who were saying, "The Lord has truly been raised and has appeared to Simon." Then the two recounted what had taken place on the way and how he was made known to them in the breaking of the bread. And the gospel of the Lord. I meant to introduce myself at the very beginning. I'm Father John, and I think I am probably the only priest in the country who had a 98-year-old brigadier general playing piano for me at Mass. It was a delight all the years he did that. When his health got too bad, then he still showed up in his scooter, and then his health got really bad, and he couldn't come anymore. But we always remembered him at Mass. I picked the first reading because it starts talking about mountains and the fact that we're going to find salvation on the holy mountain. And I figure, where else but in Colorado can you look up and figure out where the holy mountain is? So you can pick one, because there's lots of them. And so we know that God is going to save us. The second reading, just because every tear is going to be wiped away. It's a sad occasion, but we know it's also a joyous occasion, because Paul is with God. And I picked the gospel reading simply because the breaking of the bread was important to Paul. He came to Mass regularly until he couldn't. And when I saw him a couple of weeks ago, he said, "You know, the one thing I miss is that I haven't been to Mass." And I thought to myself, well, hello, dummy, me. You could do that for him. So the next day, I came in with Laverne, and we had Mass. Now, it was like a battlefield Mass because it was 4 minutes long. But it was absolutely perfect, and he got to go to Mass He was in bed, and I was sitting on the side of his bed. And I thought, okay, that's one thing I can do for Paul. And then the last thing that I remember, the last day that I saw him, he kept saying, pray for us, pray for us, pray for us. And as he was doing it, I thought, well, you know, I should be listing saints. And I started trying to name all the saints I could remember, and my mind was going blank, and I didn't get very far. But he kept saying, pray for us, pray for us. And I thought to myself, now, you know, we have saints up there praying for us, but we now have Paul up there who is also saying, pray for us, because that's who he is. He's not just up there sitting around. He's up there praying for us. And so we celebrate that on this Memorial Day, on this Memorial Mass. And so we bring our prayers before the Lord.
In baptism, Paul received the light of Christ. Scatter the darkness now and lead him over the prayers of death. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Our brother Paul was nourished at the table of our Savior. Welcome him into the halls of heavenly banquet. Lord, in your mercy. Many friends and members of the families have gone before us and with the kingdom. Grant them an everlasting home with your Son. Lord, in your mercy. Those who trusted in the Lord, now sleep in the Lord. Give refreshment, rest, and peace to all whose faith is known to you alone. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Family and friends of Paul seek comfort and consolation. Heal their pain, dispel the darkness and doubt that come from grief. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We assemble here in faith and confidence to pray for Brother Paul. Strengthen our hope so we may live in the expectation of your Son's coming. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
God, our shelter and our strength, you listen to the love, in love to the cry of your people. Hear the prayers we offer for Paul, and grant us them the fullness of redemption. And we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have this bread to offer you. Fruit of the earth and the work of human hands will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
And blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have this wine to offer you. Fruit of the vine and the work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
And pray that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God the Father Almighty. Be near, O Lord, we pray, to your servant Paul, on whose this day we offer you this sacrifice of reconciliation, so that should any stain of sin have clung to him or any human fault have affected him, it may be your loving gift be forgiven and wiped away through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the Lord be with you.
Yes,
lift up your hearts.
Yes,
and let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
Yes,
it is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Almighty God, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your Word, through whom you made all things, whom you sent as our Savior and Redeemer, incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin, Fulfilling your will and gaining few holy people, he stretched out his hands as he endured his passion, so as to break the bonds of death and manifest the resurrection. And so with the angels and all the saints, we declare your glory as with one voice we acclaim, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. And do this in memory of me. And the mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. And remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Samuel our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, especially Paul, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face, and have mercy on us all, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
And so we pray together the words that Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom
and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let's offer each other the sign of peace.
The Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. And we break bread together because Jesus broke bread, and they recognized him in the breaking of the bread.
And behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
And let us pray. Grant, Almighty God, that your servant Paul, who has journeyed from this world, may, by the sacrifice we have offered, be cleansed and freed from sin and filled with joy, and so receive the everlasting joys of the resurrection. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the Lord be with you.
And
may Almighty God bless us in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go in peace, and find the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God. Just one final comment. I think the thing that I will miss most about Paul is his smile.
Weak, I am worn through.
I'm Paul, son of Paul. And on behalf of the whole family, I want to thank all of you and welcome you for coming to help celebrate the life of Paul Phillips, my father. Now we're going to have a series of tributes from members of the family, but we recognize that that's an impossible task. How do you do justice to a man who lived not for 80 years, not 90 years, not 100 years, but 105 years? How do you do that? Where do you begin? Duty, honor, country. Duty, honor, country. The motto of West Point, which my father lived by and which he embodied in every chapter of his life. The first chapter was in the Philippines. He graduated in 1940, married my mother Rita, who he called Reitz, within 2 weeks, and they headed for the Philippine Islands, where they had heard that you could live like royalty on $125 a month, which was then the salary of a second lieutenant in the US Army. And they soon greeted their first child, my sister Nancy, and it was a tropical paradise until Pearl Harbor. Nancy and my mother were on the last boat home from the Philippines to the United States, and my dad went to war. He fought the invasion on the island of Mindanao, was awarded the Silver Star for valor in battle. His commanding officer was named General Sharp, and General Sharp surrendered Mindanao to the Japanese, but he released all the out islands under his command so that they could fight on against the invasion. The Japanese commander would have nothing of this. He said, no, you get those people back under your command and surrender, or the executions are going to begin. So General Sharp summoned four officers for a special mission. My dad was one of them, the only one of the four to survive the war. And the mission was to go out to the out islands and get the commanders there to surrender and come back under General Sharp's command so that the executions would not begin. And my dad, in his memoir, does an amazing description of this. First, he was flown in a DC-3 by a barefooted pilot to an out city. And then he rode in an outrigger canoe across one of the inland seas of the Philippines at nightfall while all the lights of the fishing boats were in the distance. It sounds like a movie, doesn't it? He finally got to the island. He found the colonel who was in command, and he spent several hours trying to persuade that colonel to come back under General Sharp's command and to surrender. He's a second lieutenant. This is a colonel. But he succeeded. He was always a very persuasive man. But just about that time, some friends of his showed up and they said, Paul, we have a 500-ton boat, it's fueled, it's got food and water, we're going to make a run to Australia. Will you come with us? So he faced a choice, freedom and rejoining his family or duty. And you know what he chose, duty, honor, and country. And 3.5 years of prison camp as a result of that choice. That's always stood to me as the epitome of an honorable man. But before he went into prison camp, he got sports equipment for the soldiers. He bought volleyball equipment and softball equipment because he knew that that would help keep morale up. And by the way, those friends of his who took the 500-ton boat, they all made it. He met them at the top of the mark in San Francisco after the war was over, and they, of course, said, you should have come with us. Duty, honor, country. In prison camp, other qualities of my father came out. He survived beatings. He survived the infamous hell ships, days and weeks of terrible conditions locked in the hold of these old hulks where they were being transported to Japan. He survived twice the bombing of those hell ships by American troops because the ships were not marked, and helped rescue other prisoners in the flight to the land. 5 out of 6 of the prisoners of war on the hell ships died. He was one of those lucky 1 out of 6 to survive. He survived being starved almost to death. He weighed 90 pounds when he was finally rescued in August of 1945. So that quality of endurance, of resilience, of incredible inability to be cowed by anything, that was one of his signal traits that lasted his whole life. But another trait came out in prison camp, and that was that besides being the ultimate survivor, he was a true optimist. I asked him once, who are the people that survived prison camp? And he said, oh, it wasn't the strongest, it wasn't the biggest, it wasn't the highest ranking. It was the people who had a positive attitude. And that was my dad. He always kept a positive attitude, whatever the circumstances. He told me, I always knew America would win the war. I always knew I would make it back home to Nancy and to Reitz. He had that undying confidence. The next chapter of my dad's life saw him rise up the ladder in the military, ever-increasing responsibility and commands, teaching. He kept getting sent back to the Pentagon because he was viewed as a very gifted strategic mind, and they wanted him there at the center of the Army to plan the future. Then he was sent to the National War College, which has been called the Prep School for Generals. Then the faculty of the Army War College, from which he was promoted to Brigadier General and sent back to the office of the Chief of Staff in the Pentagon. During that time, my dad was working very, very hard, 6 days a week, sometimes 7. And from reading his journals as I was preparing for this talk, I came to find out that that was a time when he felt real conflict between the duty he had to the Army to do his best and the duty he had to his family. And he wrote there, I know when I come to be judged before God, it's not going to be how many stars I have, it's going to be how well did I discharge my duty to my family. Well, he needn't have worried, because he was a magnificent father. I had no idea he felt this conflict. For me, he was always there, always present. He taught me basketball, baseball, squash, tennis. And here I have a confession. Even when he was a slightly overweight 55-year-old guy, I still never could take a tennis set off of him. He was an incredible strategist. That strategic mind worked in tennis, too, and he'd run me ragged. And even to this day, I never took a set off him. I should have challenged him in these last months. But I did get to where I could beat him in squash, thank heavens. Something, some bit of pride there. And he was one of the best tennis players in the Army. He had boxes full of all kinds of trophies from all the tennis tournaments he had won in the Army. But he also taught me camping and fishing and how to make things. There was the canvas canoe that we bought out of Boy's Life that was supposed to take 2 weekends to prepare. It took us the whole summer to build that thing and many sore fingers, but by golly, we got that canoe built and painted and had many happy years with it. That was the kind of dad he was, even when he was fulfilling these incredibly important responsibilities for the nation. But he taught me so much more. Always do your best. Respect everyone. Contribute, because to whom much is given, much is expected. But he didn't teach me those lessons in words. He taught me those lessons by who he was and how he lived his life. And that, those lessons have stuck. After retiring from active duty in the Army, Dad went right back to the Army as a high-ranking civilian. And in that role, he helped design and implement the all-volunteer Army, which of course is the Army that we have now had for 40-some years. Even though philosophically, he did not agree with the all-volunteer Army. The reason? He felt that the children of senators and the children of millionaires ought to have exactly the same opportunity and danger of serving the country in its wars. But he still did his duty to create that army. He was such a democratic person in his spirit. He treated everyone with respect, just like he taught me to treat them. So then came the chapter of actual final retirement, where with my mother, he moved back to Colorado, up in the mountains near Winter Park. This was an idyllic period for them. They learned to ski, they had many friends. He ran the Grand County Historic Society. He said, you know, it's really not that hard a job. Grand County has less history than most counties in America. And he doted on his grandkids tremendously, some of whom are here. My mother, they celebrated their 50th wedding anniversary, and then sadly, my mother died not long after that. My dad was heartbroken, of course. In time, he re-met a woman he had known in high school, Dottie Evans, and he courted her, and they married, and they had 15 very happy, idyllic years themselves. This man had many chapters in his life. But again, that's a sign of his character, this tremendous resilience, always looking forward, always moving forward. That was my dad, and maybe that's the most important lesson he taught me. And then we come to the Windcrest chapter. And Dad loved Windcrest. I think first he fell in love with it because it reminded him of an army base. There's a guardhouse out front. You're checked that you're able to enter here. He was on a floor where, as he said, this is so great. The mess hall is just a walk right out my door. He always called it the mess hall. And he took on many leadership roles here at Windcrest, had many wonderful friends. All of you were his wonderful friends, are his wonderful friends. He taught the Great Decisions course. He taught scores of people Mahjong. He played the organ or the piano, as Father John mentioned. He lectured about the Second World War at schools all over the metro area at Regis University. He was on the governor's board on nursing homes and how to make them better. So he continued to be a totally active citizen, involved in doing good and contributing and taking a leadership role. He was always front and center when Windcrest had drives to raise money for the Resident Care Fund, for the scholarship fund. He was incredibly philanthropic. Towards the end, when he could no longer write checks, I wrote checks for him. He was supporting about 40 charities a month. I'm not kidding. When his health, well, one other thing first. And then, of course, there was his famous 100th birthday, when he brought free drinks for everybody in Windcrest. At that time, that was like 1,500 people. And he loved it. He loved a beau geste. The only problem was when he turned 101, he said all these people were coming up to him and saying, where are the free drinks, Paul? So as his health and mobility started to fail, and he needed 24-hour care, he didn't lose community. He built community among the people. And here they are right here in the second row who took care of him. Thank you, ladies. You were wonderful. He did many kind things to them. I remember many Thanksgiving dinners with the family and them and Dad in his apartment. He was a loving and lovable man. Maybe not the typical general, but a lovable and loving man. So how to sum up Paul Phillips? Two words. American hero. He put everything on the line for this country. And then for the rest of his life, lived with tremendous dedication, integrity, and generosity of heart to make every community he was part of better. People would sometimes say to me, "Your dad is a tough act to follow." And that's true. That was true then, it's true now, it'll always be true. But I revel in that. I revel in that. I'm so proud of him, so grateful to be his son, so grateful for everything he did for me. And we can together give thanks that we knew Paul Phillips, American hero. My sister Nancy, I'm honored to introduce now as the next speaker.
You are a tough act to follow. I'm going to call this next piece Dress Rehearsal. Good morning. Thank you for coming to the celebration of my dad, Paul Phillips. As is noted in the program, our dad had a wonderful sense of humor. And perhaps the story will prove that. But you decide if he was pranking us or if this is really true. It was late afternoon on July 21st, and my sister, Rita Ann, called. She wanted to let me know that she had spoken with Dad, who told her to call both Dave, our brother, and me, and let us know that he wanted to talk to us because he was going to die later that night. Needless to say, I was a bit unnerved, but followed instructions and called. He answered, and I said, "Hi, Dad. Ann tells me that you're going to die tonight." A little awkward. "Yes, I am," he answered. "But I wanted you to know that you were a good and loving daughter. You raised two beautiful children, Barbara and Dave, and had a successful, wonderful career." I thanked him and told him he was a loving father and a role model for me over the years. We chatted a bit more, and I told him I loved him and that I wished him a gentle journey. He answered, "I love you too," and we hung up. I spent the night wondering when I would get the call from my sister that Dad had in fact passed. That call never came. The call that did come was that my niece Liz had been visiting her aunt in Fort Collins and decided to make the hour trip to Granddad to see how he was doing. She arrived about midnight. He was asleep in his recliner. She woke him up and then got my sister, Rita Ann, on the phone, on FaceTime. Ann says, "Well, Dad, how are you doing?" And he said, "I think I've decided I'm not dying tonight." She laughed and said, "Oh, okay, whatever you want, whatever you think is best." I called him the next day and told him that I was very glad that he had changed his mind. He replied, "Yeah, I really wasn't ready yet." "So, what do you think? Was this a prank? Or do you think he was really, he thought he was gonna die on July 21st? I have another short story to tell you about him. This is probably the most important one. When Fox TV News interviewed Dad on his 105th birthday, I mean, they brought cameras and people with mics and rolled all that stuff into his apartment. One of the questions was, of course, "So, General Phillips, what do you attribute your longevity to?" And the answer was, "Well, I'm pretty sure it was the olives in my martinis." And with that, I introduce my sweet niece, Liz Carpenter.
Morning. My uncle ruined my makeup. Thanks. Anyway, my name is Liz, and I'm Paul's second granddaughter. My mom is Rita Ann, Paul's second child. I'm going to apologize in advance to you. I've practiced this at home. But today I'd like to tell you about my granddad. From my perspective, by the time I came on the scene in 1976, my granddad had already retired from active duty, continuing to work at the Pentagon until he and my nana moved back to Colorado in 1979. My memories of that short time with them in Washington are sprinkled with images of family gatherings in Northwest, enjoying each other's company. My grandparents are by far two of the most influential people in my life, my absolute favorite people. And I would be remiss to tell you of him without mentioning my nana. They were a force, an absolute force, and always a team. I never heard a crossword between them, and their marriage consistently exuded love, support, patience, kindness, empathy, and friendship. Lessons taught to all of us, as my uncle said, by example. Even when my grandmother mistakenly drove home from a doctor's appointment, all the way back up the mountain with the parking brake on, oh God, that was a day. My granddad said nothing. He just quietly went outside and took a hose to the brake pads. And very much like the military man he was, kept it moving. The only time I sensed frustration from him was when he was trying to help me with algebra homework in the ninth grade. He did more of it than I did, and I still don't understand, at the age of 47, why numbers and letters go together in math. And I'm fairly sure we were both rather surprised when I got an A in graduate level statistics. I still have that framed. Summer spent in Colorado were filled with family, fun, adventure, and life lessons that have served me for my entire life. He and my grandmother, taught us the value of family, nature, animals, respect, hard work, patience, love, support, kindness, and the value of tolerance of all and acceptance. One of my favorite summers here was in 1979. I was 3 years old, and he bought me my very first pair of cowboy boots and put me on a horse. With the exception of today, I still live in my cowboy boots. We hiked often every summer, learning the different mountains and ranges and wildflowers, and spent most days outside exploring. We were taught to appreciate music and encouraged to play the organ and piano, even on days when I'm sure our practice gave both of them incredible headaches. We were encouraged to develop our own personal talents and interests in a safe space without judgment. Even if we made mistakes or got into trouble, they approached us with a lesson, not a punishment. And Nana would often hand us an extra Lorna Doone and say, "Don't tell your mom." We were encouraged to succeed on our own, knowing that they were in the background to help us if needed. We faithfully went to Mass weekly, as it was the cornerstone of his very existence. I struggle a great deal with the loss of this human man. He's been a beacon for my life. I stood in constant awe of him, and if ever I have a bad day, perspective always asks if it's worse than being a POW. He has been my guide, and his strength, fortitude, tenacity, generosity, compassion, love, lack of judgment in all things, kindness, friendship, and feedback have been guiding principles in my life. Words are not adequate to explain to you the impact he quietly had on my life through his example. My grandfather, as my uncle has already mentioned, is an excellent example of a simple life well lived. He served his country, raised a family. He got up and went to work every day, something he not only enjoyed, but found purposeful. His legacy are the many examples he left for us as he lived his daily life with grace, faith, gratitude, integrity, kindness, empathy, courage, friendship, and understanding. Excuse me. As I struggle with the loss of my grandfather, and even still with the loss of my grandmother, I am learning to be with them in a different way. I do not believe that people die. Bodies die, but souls live. They are with me and with all of us, always. Regardless of how you choose to seek higher spirit, I hope that you find comfort in the fact, as I do, that my grandfather with my grandmother are happy, healthy, healed, whole, and at peace. I extend personal thanks to all of the caregivers who helped my granddad weather growing old with grace and dignity, a charge with which we are all honored as caregivers. I work in a nursing home too. Those from Windcrest Home Health and Synergy offered help, patience, compassion, empathy, and love. Growing old takes courage, and my grandfather did it gracefully with your help.
I thank the staff at Mill Vista, who in the last 24 hours of his life with us, helped him finally find the peace, grace, and dignity in the final hours that he was so desperately craving. I also acknowledge hospice in their role in helping us make him comfortable. Alice, your daily loving companionship provided my granddad with great joy and helped stave off, I'm sure for both of you, the loneliness and isolation that can come with aging. I know he so enjoyed every moment he spent with you. For me, all of you are delicately and intricately woven into the fabric of our family. For the impact you've had on my grandfather. Finally, I thank my family, all of the staff at Windcrest, and those representing Fort Carson, who have worked swiftly, thoroughly, and diligently to make such a special day for us to come together to honor a man who did and does and always mean so much to so many. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Alice. You might see on the program that Helen is meant to speak next. She is not able to be here. She is in New York and just got COVID, so she would rather be here, truly. And you get me for a little while because I'm going to give her remarks as well as my own. I am a fellow grandchild of Papa. We called him Papa in our family. Our children called him Big Papa, which fit so well. So these are Helen's remarks, my big sister. On August 24th of this year, I wrote a letter to my grandfather. I understood that he was approaching the end of his life on this earth, and there were a few things I wanted to say to him. But we lost him on August 27th, and as far as I know, my letter never reached him. I took a photo of it before I put it in the mail, an intuition, I guess. Rather than resigning that letter to the Department of Undeliverable Mail, I want to share it with you now. And share it with him too. Dear Papa, I am writing you today with a heart full of love and gratitude. For my entire life, you have been a rock, a boulder of strength, coziness, good spirits, kindness, and safety. Many of my richest childhood memories are visiting you and Nana in the mountains, putting seeds out for the birds and squirrels as soon as the sun came up, playing airplane with toy food, all of the beautiful Christmas decorations and your train sets, the perfect in every detail playhouse you built for us. I always felt so happy, cozy, and safe in the mountains with you. And I return to those days often in my memory. Thank you for creating that sense of stability and care. It shaped me. I am overjoyed that Ruth and Neil, my children, got to know you well, that at this past Christmas, they heard your story of being liberated from POW camp. You are their connection to the greatest generation, and to a time of American dignity and honor. Your generosity to the needy and to animals, to children and family and friends is a model to which I will aspire for the rest of my life. Thank you, dearest Papa, for all the gifts with which you have showered me since I was born. I love you infinitely and forever. Love, Helen. She goes on. It's too bad the letter never arrived, but also, I'm pretty confident he knew all of that. Dignity. I keep coming back to that word when I think of Papa. He was definitely dignified. As a grandfather, as a general, I always sat up a little straighter and enunciated a little clearer in his presence. He also would let you know if you got it wrong. That's it, yeah. but dignified doesn't capture it all. He was also so warm, so delighted by and engaged with life. Whether corresponding with the Denver Post to critique the solution to their puzzles page, fishing in Granby, luring in and adopting free-range cats, or building a dollhouse for his grandkids from scratch. However, I do remember one incident that strained even his dignity and kindness. I'm going to remind everyone this is Helen's story. When I was around 5 years old and staying with my grandparents, I admitted to them that I hadn't gone to the bathroom number two in a few days, and I had a bad stomach ache. They rushed me to the pediatrician, who was confident that a laxative would do the trick. On the car ride home, Papa sat me up on a pile of towels, and I've never seen a man move so fast as he did to get me out of his beautiful, pristine car and into the house, right to the bathroom. Even then, though, I still felt like he was taking great care of me. One of the things I have been most grateful for in these days since Papa's death are the two memoirs he wrote when he was 84 and 90, back when he was a spring chicken. One is called A Denver Boyhood, and the other is called The Rest of My Life. His memory is absolutely extraordinary. His prose is eloquent, and he evoked his incredible life with an awe-inspiring level of thoughtfulness and detail. If you want to know which streets the streetcars ran on in North Denver in the 1920s, I have the book for you. I love flipping through Papa's memoirs, which he had printed and bound and distributed to the family. I love hearing his voice, spending time with his intelligence and wit and wisdom. I love reading them with my children. I truly can't believe we are fortunate enough to have these documents of his life, that his voice stays with us in this way. At the end of The Rest of My Life, there are many appendices, including Appendix 4, Favorite Quotes. I was surprised to see that more than one of his favorite quotes came from my favorite musician, Bob Dylan. Not exactly the obvious choice, considering that as a slightly snobby lover of classical music, he looked down even on some classical composers who are esteemed by many. One Dylan quote he included was, "He not busy being born is busy dying." And it doesn't surprise me that these words struck him. Papa, his whole life, was busy being born, again and again, embracing life and people at every stage, embracing all of us as we each entered his life until the very tail end. And another of his favorite quotes to leave us all with, "I alone cannot change the world, but I can cast a stone across the waters to cause many ripples." Mother Teresa. We are those ripples. So those are Helen's remarks. Okay, and now I want to share my own. In the past few months, it seemed like the end might be coming. And I have to say, I am surprised at how sad I am. I thought it was the obvious thing that a man of 105 would go. And arriving in Colorado yesterday, there's just a feeling of something gone, something missing that has always been there. I was picturing like the mountains, a familiar view of the mountains, but some piece just not there. Or the feel is like the gravitational pull of planets and then a piece just being gone. So I'm so grateful to be here today, to be in community together, to remember him. And I want to share with you a few of the things about him that will stay with me. One is his presence and his playfulness as a grandparent. I have such early memories of him getting on the ground and playing with us, playing cards with us. We saw him weekly up through high school. He would stop by our house and play games with us. And every Christmas, folks here might remember, he would put a little contraption outside of his door that had, it was mechanical, and little balls would be shot up and wind around. And it was so playful, and he loved just watching it and seeing people stop and enjoy it. That was one of the things when my parents have been clearing out things. I was like, well, where is that? We need to keep that. And I also know that he, in that playfulness and presence, I really think it's something that my parents got to see modeled. And in the last few years of the pandemic and parenting, you may have seen my little kiddos running around here, but I've had the opportunity to lean on my parents in a way that I never thought I would need to. And the play and presence they bring with my children is, it's really unbelievable. It's such a huge gift. And no pressure to my kids, but if I'm as lucky to be a grandparent also, that's something that I will bring forward. Another thing that really strikes me about Papa was his creativity. He was such a musician. He also, he has etchings from his home that were always hung up in his space. And he always sent us Christmas cards and birthday cards. And there was a period, I was trying to remember when, probably the early 2000s or so, but he was really ahead of the curve of actually creating your own cards. So he really mastered like clip art and putting cards together. So those I received with such joy. And something that I do a lot with my children is send cards. And we sent some to Papa that like Helen's didn't make it before he was gone, but that's that act of sending a card and sharing love through the creation of some expression. That's something that we will carry forward. A final thing I want to share is the comfort I got from being with an elder, from being with someone with such wisdom and such life experience. When my oldest sister, Catherine, passed away 11 years ago, the people at her bedside were me and my parents and Papa. And it gave me such comfort during a challenging time to have him there as we said goodbye to her. And that is, it's really something I'll keep with me forever. So today I'm toasting, though I don't have a drink, but toasting Papa's playfulness and presence. I'm toasting his creativity, and I'm toasting his wisdom. Thank you. Okay. And now I get to introduce you to my daughter, Tess, who wants to share a little something about Papa.
I'm so glad that Big Papa lived for so long and I got to love him for so long.
Okay. And next is my brother, Mark.
Well, that's a lot of good stuff we've heard so far. I don't think I can add much on my grandfather's kindness or his gentleness of spirit or his sense of duty and honor. I want to take a slightly different perspective. I live on the central coast of California, next to an area that was logged all the way to the Bear Hills in 1920. And the past 2 weeks, I've been walking through what is now a towering redwood forest. And for these past 2 weeks, I've been thinking most of these trees are younger than my grandfather. You're talking about a 200-foot-tall redwood that contains an entire ecosystem. There are owls, there are squirrels, there are whole worlds in these upper branches. And in many ways, I think that that physical representation is a better understanding of what a life like Papa's means to our community and to our society than these small human forms that we carry with us. These big trees, they create shade for us. They protect us from fires. They are the tent poles that hold up larger portions of our world. And Papa was very much that. His clarity of purpose, his clear kindness and goodness, his sense of respect to all people, these are guideposts. And when the big trees fall over, there's no getting it back. They create something new in their wake. And what we carry as a family, that is what it is. You know, we are now the saplings that have to reach towards that light that is open now because one of the big trees has fallen. Papa, thank you for the presence that you had in my life. Thank you for the millions of chess games where you beat me across the board, back and forth. Thank you for untangling fishing line after fishing line after fishing line at the pond in Granby. Thank you for netting my first trout. Thank you for a love of nature and for a love of Colorado that is a fundamental aspect of my life and something that I carry with me at all times. I'm filled with such gratitude for having such an extraordinary guide for 37 years of my life. And I will miss you terribly. Thank you so much all for being here.
It was 50 years ago, almost to the day, that this guy, Paul Phillips, came up to me and asked me to go for a run. We were first-year law students at Yale, and I went for that run, and here I am, a half century later. What I didn't know was that I would have for 50 years not one, but two Paul Phillipses. My Paul Phillips is great, but the fact is, he was not the real Paul Phillips. As I think you could tell from the remarks today, the general was a giant. He was slight of stature, but he loomed so large in all of our lives. He was utterly, wickedly brilliant. He is the only person I've ever known who did the New York Times crossword puzzle every day in ink. We went up to his apartment after his death, and there on the dining room table was the New York Times crossword puzzle being worked on in ink. If you wanted to know the price of bread in Denver in 1925, ask Paul, ask the general, not my Paul, the giant, the general. It was a nickel. He knew all of the names of his elementary school teachers. He was truly extraordinary. He wasn't just a great war hero and prisoner of war. Wherever he went, wherever he landed, he just took a charge. If it was the HOA of his homeowners association in Fraser, Colorado, he was leading it. He couldn't help himself. That's what he did. He also had a real love of the absurd in life. And a few years ago, he told me this story. He said, "Sue, this woman called me. She had such a nice voice. And she went on and on. She was selling life insurance." And finally, after she'd done her whole spiel, he was gracious enough to let her finish. He said, "Ma'am, I'm 103. And she said, "God bless," and hung up. On his 105th birthday, imagine getting to your 105th birthday. But this was quite an extravaganza, because that day he was awarded a certificate from West Point that he was the oldest living graduate. And the person who brought him that certificate was the current superintendent of West Point, a three-star general. And he came to Paul's room here in Windcrest and spent hours with him, because he knew that he was looking at one of the last of the greatest generation. But afterwards, the thing that tickled Paul so much, the general so much, was that he kept saying, "Sue," he kept calling me "sir." The whole time he called me "sir." And it was so great, because you knew that somewhere in the heart of this remarkable man, he was still that little cadet at West Point, and he could not believe that he was being called "sir." So there's so much about my father-in-law, but you heard Alice, my Alice, talk a little bit about our daughter, Catherine. Catherine was the eldest of our four children, and Kat was profoundly handicapped. She couldn't walk, talk, or feed herself. We did a very intensive program with her called Patterning, where we had 100 volunteers come to our house every week. We were trying to fix our precious Catherine. Sadly, we could not do that. But every week, Paul and Rita, they lived in Fraser at the time, they would drive down on Wednesday evenings. Rita would bring us a great dinner, and Paul would pattern Catherine. She loved him. Here you had this tough, hard-nosed, utterly brilliant military man, and he made our little Catherine feel like she hung the moon. And now I am absolutely certain that Catherine welcomed him and said, "Now I've just got another angel on my team." I am sure of that. So when Paul was 98, he gave me the most beautiful wedding gift. I mean, not wedding gift, Christmas gift, excuse me. And it was a one of those fabulous cable knit sweaters from the Aran Islands in Ireland. It was gorgeous, Kelly Green, so pretty. And then he proceeded every year to give me a gorgeous Aran sweater. So I now have 6 or 7. But when we went up to his apartment after his death, there, up on the shelf in his closet, was this year's sweater. So, Paul, thank you. I got it. Thank you. I appreciate it. Nancy mentioned that it was the olives and the martinis. In fact, from years of observation, this is the secret to a long life. I know that's not the case. What it was this: never eat a vegetable and eat lots and lots of chocolate and Scottish shortbread. I'm telling you, it works. So Paul was proof positive that that's the secret to a life of 105 years. But seriously, what is the secret? This man had a disposition unlike anyone I've ever known. He never held a grudge, even after being a prisoner of war. He was not angry. He was not bitter. He looked forward. He made the best always, and the best was great. He accepted life, and he made the best of whatever was thrown his way with such exuberance, such intelligence, such heart, and such care. So Paul died on August 27th. It was a long day. It was a long weekend. He was very ready by then to leave this earth. We ended up driving home probably at 11 o'clock that night. I've lived in Colorado. We've lived here more than 40 years. We have never encountered a storm like the storm that we went out into on August 27th. It was windy, it was raining, it was thunder, it was lightning. We could hardly see out of our windshield. It was as if the universe was weeping. I know it was, but I also had this thought. I thought, oh no, this is a cosmic tussle between Dottie and Rita. How are they gonna figure this out? What's gonna happen here? And then I thought, no, I'm not going to worry. The general's there. He's going to take command. Everything is going to work out. I won the father-in-law lottery. All of us in this room who knew this remarkable human being won the lottery. What a man. What a love. What a life.
seat is instead. Ladies and gentlemen, can you hear me? I can see that here. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Major General retired Steve Crest from the West Point class of 1976. What I'd like to describe very briefly for you is the military honors that are now about to be rendered to celebrate and commemorate the service and sacrifice of our fallen brother, Brigadier General Paul Phillips. We will start this portion of military honors with the rendering of taps, which dates itself all the way back to the Civil War as a traditional way of honoring a fallen comrade. I would ask at that time that you rise as you are able, as is tradition, consider placing your hand on your heart for those in your active military that are present, retirees, or fellow veterans are welcome to render a hand salute. Upon the completion of taps, one of the three flags here that will be presented today will be unfolded, will be refolded by our honor guard and will be presented to Paul's daughter, Nancy. And then we'll have two other presentations, one of a presidential memorial certificate that has our commander-in-chief's signature affixed to it, and also a letter of condolence from the president of the West Point Association of Graduates. Following the military honors portion of this, and the playing of God Bless America, that will end this service to today. The family invites you all to follow them as they're escorted outside for reception following the ceremony.
Thank you. join us in singing God Bless America, and then afterwards to join the family in the foyer for a little reception.
America, my home, sweet.